Welcome to the next module of the course. In the first module of the course, we looked at bit vector data flow frameworks, which are the simplest kinds of data flow analysis problems. The goal of the first module was to introduce the basic concepts of data flow analysis to you. Having seen the basic concepts of data flow analysis, now we want to build on the earlier concepts that we have seen. And what are the concepts that we have seen? We have seen that data flow analyses can be defined in terms of path properties, properties of certain program paths. And then we can define a system of simultaneous equations that computes the set of variables or expressions that satisfy those properties. And we found out that we can solve this system of simultaneous equations by performing a round robin analysis, starting with a conservative initialization and refining the values repeatedly. We also talked about the situations when the solution we found so was expected to be sound, when it was not expected to be sound, when it was precise. We had seen all these concepts at an intuitive level. It's time now for us to formalize these concepts. So in this module, we are going to look at the need for a more general setting, and then we'll try to generalize data flow values, set of flow functions, solutions of data flow analysis, algorithms for performing data flow analysis, and finally the complexity of data flow analysis. And while we take examples of specific analyses to illustrate the point, the issues that we're going to discuss are at a general level and are applicable to all data flow analyses. So let's first begin by looking at why we need to talk about a more general setting. Why is it that what we have seen in bit vector frameworks is not sufficient? So what we've seen so far is we've seen these analyses, live variables analysis, available expressions analysis, partially available expressions analysis, anticipable expressions analysis, and reaching definitions analysis. So it looks like we have looked at various things. So we have, for example, looked at the use of a variable, availability, use of a variable, availability of an expression, use of an expression, availability of definition. We talked about paths starting at P and some paths. Then we talked about paths reaching P and all paths. Then we talked about paths reaching P and some paths. Then we talked about in anticipable expressions analysis, paths starting at P, and we wanted to focus on properties that must be satisfied by all paths. For reaching definitions analysis, we talked about paths reaching P, and it was fine if the property was satisfied by some paths, but not necessarily all paths. So looks like we have seen quite a bit of variety, but why is it that it is still not sufficient? In order to understand this, we need to look at a new analysis called constant propagation to observe why what we have seen so far doesn't really suffice. So what do we do in constant propagation? In constant propagation, we identify variables that are supposed to have constant values at a program point. And we say a variable V is a constant with value C at a program point P if in every execution instance of P, the value of V is C, which means that in every possible run of the program, the variable has a known value, and this value is known at compile time. So there is no need to perhaps perform computations using these values at runtime, and we will see what we mean by this. So we begin by looking at an example, an introduction to constant propagation. This is an example from the book by M.S. Hecht. So this, we have assignments to A and B, and then we add A and B to compute C, and then we have, once again, we compute C as A plus B, and then we have D is equal to A star B, and then we have D is equal to C minus 1, A is equal to 2, B is equal to 1, and C is equal to A plus B. So the interesting thing is that in the beginning we have A equal to 1 and B equal to 2, and later we have A equal to 2 and B equal to 1. So we just swap the values of A and B. As a consequence, what happens is the value of A plus B remains same. Because whether a is 1 and b is 2, or whether b is 1 or a is 2, the value of a plus b remains same. Similarly, the value of a star b remains same even if the values are swapped. So although the values of variables a and b are changing, it's easy to see the values of c and d do not change in the program. And that's what we wish to discover through our analysis. So let's try to imagine execution traces for this program. Let's try to look at a particular execution sequence. Initially, we do not know the values of the variables. So at the entry of N1, this is the basic block N1. At the entry of N1, we do not know the values of A, B, C, D. So we are showing the values of A, B, C, D as a 4-tuple. Okay. So, at the end of basic block 1, we know that A has been assigned value 1 and B has been assigned value 2 and C is sum of the 2. So, therefore, A is 1, B is 2, C is 3 and D remains question mark in the sense that we still do not know what the value of D is. From the exit of N1, now the program reaches, the control flow reaches the entry of N2, which is, so the values at the entry of N2 remain the same, and now we find out the values at the exit of N2. At the exit of N2, we compute C is equal to A plus B, so C remains 3, and then we compute D as a product of A star B, so therefore the value of B now becomes 2. And now the control reaches from N2 to N3, and therefore we have this value, same value at the start of N3. However, at the end of N3, some values change. And which are these values that change? The values that change are essentially the values of A and B. Earlier, A was 1. Now, A has been made 2. Earlier, B was 2. Now, B has been made 1. So, instead of 1 and 2 here, we have 2 and 1. However, D is computed as C minus 1 and C was 3. So, therefore, D remains 2. And C is recomputed as A plus B. A is 2. B is 1. And therefore, the value of C is 3. So we get 2, 1, 3, 2 at the entry of N3. And after N3, assume that the loop is executed once. We take this package and reach the entry of N2. And therefore, we get the values 2, 1, 3, 2 at the entry of N2. At the exit of N2, we continue to get the same values 2, 1, 3, 2 because C is A plus B and D is equal to A star B. Now, at the entry of N3, we have values 2, 1, 3, 2. At the exit of N3, the values remain 2, 1, 3, 2. Assuming that the loop is executed once, we keep getting the same values. So this is an execution trace. But when we perform static analysis, we cannot be computing values along different execution paths. We want values at a program point that are common to all execution paths. We want to talk about some property of all paths, some property to be satisfied by the paths. And therefore, we try to summarize. We try to summarize the values at a program point. So how do we summarize? We summarize the values by combining many values. So we start computing the summary value. And the entry, we associate the value empty, empty, empty. What are we trying to say? We're trying to say, let us try to find out the set of possible values of a variable at a given program point. Here, we have not seen any value of any variable, and therefore, we use empty set. Note that another choice could have been to use any possible random value, and we could have, if we assume uninitialized values, then we could use Z, which is the universal set, as the boundary value. Here we have chosen empty value, empty sets as the boundary value. This is based on the assumption that the execution paths are so set up using conditions that no variable is read before it is defined. If this is not the case, and which may not in general be the case, it is customary to use Z as the boundary value. For the time being, we will continue using empty set as the boundary value. We can always change it to z at a different point, and we will see what difference does it make. So for the time being, let's assume that our boundary value is the empty set of values for every variable. Okay, now we compute the values at the entry of at the exit of program point n, basic block n1, and there is exactly one instance of out of n1, and therefore we have this set 1, 2, 3, and this is empty set. So this is a set of, so A has exactly one value 1, B has exactly one value 2, C has exactly one value 3, and Z does not have any value by our assumption that the boundary info is empty set. Now we want to find out the values at the entry of N2, and there are many instances of entries of N2, and we need to combine all these values. So at the entry of N2, we have these values. At one place we have 1, 2, 3. At the other entry point, at other instance of the entry of N2, we have 2, 1, 3, 2. At the third instance of entry of N2, we have 2, 1, 3, 2. So when we take the union of these values, we get 1, 2 for A, and again 1, 2 for B, only 3 for C, and empty set and 2, so 2 for D. Now we don't want to keep recording all possible values. We make a simple approximation. We over approximate the set 1, 2 to Z, implying that multiple values are possible, and by multiple values we mean any value. This is fine because our interest is in knowing whether there exists one unique value in all execution instances. So long as we know that two values are possible, it doesn't matter to us whether two values are possible or three values are possible. All we know is that the variable is not constant at that program point. So in order to simplify the matters, we just over approximate 1, 2 to Z. So we say that all possible, any value is possible for A, any value is possible for B, meaning A is not constant, multiple values are possible for B, multiple values are possible for A. Similarly, when we summarize the data flow values at the exit of N2, we get Z32 by combining different values at different occurrences of the exit of N2. At the exit of N3, once again we get Z32. At the exit of N3, now we get 2, 1, 3, 2, because in every instance of N3 we have A has value 2, A has value 2 here, A has value 2 here, and A has value 2 here. Similarly, B has value 1, B has value 1, B has value 1, and we know that is not incidental because A is assigned a value 2 here and B is assigned a value 1 here. So this is the kind of summary value that we would like our analysis to compute. This is the desired solution. So in order to compute this solution, let's see whether what we have done in BitVector data flow frameworks is sufficient. We observe that our data flow values are tuples of the form eta1, eta2 to eta k, or sets of pairs vi to eta I, where eta I is the data flow value of the ith variable. So they are maps from variables to values. And what are the values? The values, unlike BitVector data flow frameworks, the values are not 0 or 1 or true or false. Instead, values are one of the following. It's either an empty set indicating no value is known for the variable, or Z indicating that variable VI could have multiple values, or it is a singleton set C1. If the value of VI is known to be C1 at compile time, meaning in all execution instances of the program, the value of VI is C1 at this particular program point. Now this clearly is difficult to describe using BitVector data flow framework. So that's a difference number one. Our data flow values are of a different kind. The second difference is data flow dependence of data flow values across entities. So in BitVector frameworks, data flow values of different entities are independent, meaning we could perform liveness analysis of variable B without looking at liveness of some other variable. Similarly, the analysis of expression A star B does not depend on that of any other expressions. All these are completely independent. Whereas in constant propagation, given a statement B star C, we cannot determine the constantness of A independently of the constantness of B and C. We can't say, let me find out everywhere if B is constant, then I will find out whether C is constant, and later I will find out whether A is constant. That cannot happen because the values of different entities depend on each other. It doesn't happen in BitVector data flow frameworks. The third difference is the way we merge the values. So we have a map. Let's say A, the set for A is S1 along one path, and set for A is S2 along one path. So we have A maps to S1 along one path and A maps to S2 along one path, the other path. So therefore we want to merge these values. So we see we use with this notation called meet operation or the merge operation. And if we have A as empty set along both the paths, then the result is empty set. If we have A as along one path and empty set along the other path, it remains Z. If we have Z along both the paths, then it is Z. If we have Z along one path and C1 along the other path, the union gives us Z. However, if we have C1 along one path, C2 along one path, and empty set along one path, it is C2. If we have C2 along one path and Z along the other path, it is Z. So far, so good, but this is the tricky case. If we have C1 along one path and C2 along both, along the other path, if the values are same, then it is C1, otherwise it is Z. This is neither intersection nor union. So we have a different kind of a different kind of merging that's happening, and we need to talk about what are its properties. It's different from union. It's doing some kind of an over approximation. So that's the difference number three. And the difference number four is that our data flow functions, our flow functions are defined slightly differently. So if we have R is equal to A1 cross A2, if both A1 and A2 are known to be constants, then we will say R maps to the product of these two. Otherwise, if any one of them is Z, if anyone has multiple values, we say R could have multiple values. Similarly, if any one of them has empty value, but the other is not multiple values, then we say no value is possible. This cannot be expressed in the standard form of gen union x minus kill, where gen and kill are constant effects of block n. So these are some of the important differences, but the most important difference is the fifth one. The solution that we compute by iterative method seems to be different from the desired solution, and let's see how. Let's see, we compute the data flow values in iteration one. Here we have empty set. For simplicity, we omit the braces for singleton sets so that we have fewer symbols on the slides. So we write this as 1, 2, 3 empty set, 1, 2, 3 empty set, 1, 2, 3, 2. So these are the values that we get when we perform one iteration proceeding in this direction. At the end of N3, we have value 2, 1, 3, 2. And then we perform the second iteration. Now what happens in the second iteration is, here we have 1, 2, 3 empty. This doesn't change. But here along one path, we are getting the value of C, we are getting the value of A as 2, and along the other path we are getting the value of A as 1. So 1 and 2 are over approximated to Z. Similarly, the value of B is also over approximated to Z. The value of C remains 3, value of D after the union of empty set and 2 becomes 2. Which means that we are saying that at the start of N2, the value, multiple values for A and multiple values for B are possible. Then when we try to compute the value of C, because multiple values of A and B are possible, therefore we say multiple values of C are possible. Similarly, we are taking a product of A star B, so we say multiple values of B, D are also possible. So we compute Z, Z, Z here, and then we get 2, 1, 3, Z here. In iteration 3, we get these values. Here, because of this Z here, we get at the entry, D could also have multiple values. And then we continue to get Z, Z, Z for A, B, C, and D at the exit of node N2. This is different from the desired solution. In the desired solution, we had seen that here we get C as 3 and D as 2, but here we are saying multiple values of C are possible and multiple values of D are possible. The reason why this happens is at the start of node 2, at the start of basic block 2, we have merged the values of A and B. We have done the over approximation and we are computing the value of C from these over approximated values. Whereas if we were to traverse different paths differently, we will not over approximate the values. Instead, the values of A and B will keep switching between 2 and 1, but their sum remains 3. We see that our iterative method does not give us this solution. So that's a big difference. We are unable to compute the desired solution using the method that worked for bit vector data flow frameworks. So we need to be able to answer this question, why these are the differences. So here are the important issues in data flow analysis. We want to first talk about data flow values, then we want to talk about the acceptable operations on these data flow values, then we talked about the desired solutions that we can compute for data flow values, then we talk about the practical algorithms that compute these data flow values. So when we talk about data flow values, we want to talk about the semantics of data flow values. What do they represent? What is the representation that we use to store these data flow values? What are the approximations that happen in data flow values? And for this, we will study things called partial order, and we will do lattice theoretic modeling of data flow values. When we talk about acceptable operations, we define these two operations, how to merge the data flow values and how to compute new data flow values. We define flow functions which, given a value, tell us compute a new value from a given value. And we talk about these properties of the merge function. We require the merge function to be commutative, associative, and idempotent. We require our flow functions to be monotonic, distributive, and bounded, finally separable. So we want to study all these properties of these operations. The advantage of studying properties of these operations is that once we have identified the exact properties that the operations are supposed to satisfy, then any operation that meets those properties, satisfies those properties, is good enough. It will serve our purpose. Then we want to talk about the desired solutions. We want to talk about the existence of the solutions. I mean, we want certain solution, but can these solutions exist? And if they exist, are they computable? Can we compute them? And whatever we are able to compute, is it sound? Are the solutions sound? Are the solutions precise? So we should be able to formalize these. We should be able to talk about these properties mathematically. Finally, when we talk about practical algorithms, we need to be able to talk about the complexity of these algorithms. We need to talk about the efficiency of these algorithms. we need to talk about whether these algorithms converge, whether they terminate, and if they terminate, do they converge on the value that we are interested in. And because these could be iterative algorithms, we want to talk about what should be the right initial value in order to get the right kind of solution. So these are the issues that we wish to study in this particular module called Theoretical Abstractions in Data Flow Analysis.